All right, welcome back to the Vulcun Deckmasters grand finals day, basically. So maybe some of you didn't see the initial intro, but we were waiting for Surrender to start the day.
And
He's
he's here.
facing off. He's gonna be facing off against Lifecoach in the first match. Should be nice.
Yeah, a bit of a grudge match, as you mentioned. I didn't quite see the original series, but it did sound like an exciting one. Every time I was here, you mentioned how Lifecoach was really, really frustrated about it, and maybe he'll get a chance to get some payback here. Although I'm sure, both players are pretty disappointed not to be playing in the final. That's kind of how it is. We're awarding 5,000 to third place and 3,000 to fourth. So this is basically a best of five for $2,000 more. And that's a pretty good deal. That's worth showing up for, I'd imagine.
Yeah, I mean, if only for the. I mean, he's already in the money no matter what. So all the players who are here today are, already doing pretty well. Mm-hmm. Plus, they're getting BlizzCon points. Both Lifecoach and Surrender will be getting 20 points for BlizzCon, no matter who wins. So it's really just, as you said, for the money discrepancy and a little bit of a pride thing as well. For Lifecoach getting that. Again, for Surrender, it's also pretty cool. I beat Lifecoach twice in that tournament, so the first time was no luck. That's also something to add to your resume, I guess.
Yeah, Surrender overall did really well in the tournament, from what I recall. He didn't lose at all in the group stages. I think he was the only player to do that. But he ended up losing right before this round. I think he lost to Cypher. It was.
I think he lost. Yeah, he lost to Cypher. No, I think he lost to Trump 3-0.
Oh,
yeah,
to Trump,
actually,
yeah.
It was a crazy match.
Trump 3-0'd Surrender.
Yeah, apparently it happened within 30 minutes. So it was like. Surrender went through his group stage not losing to anyone, and the next thing you know, Trump comes in, is like, let me just go through this and end up in the grand finals, and he ends up 3-0-ing Surrender. That must have felt like a bit of a shock, I guess.
Yep. I think Trump has also only lost one game, if I'm not mistaken.
From the group stage?
Yeah, he only lost to Herudra.
Yeah, which is actually a player who qualified. Who got through the open qualifiers and really like mostly an unknown players, and that was the first week, if I recall, with a Druid deck that I think really got a convincing win against Trump. So
yeah,
he still caught up and did really well after that point.
Trump will be facing off Cypher in the final, who actually lost to Surrender and to Lifecoach, which are both our fourth and third placers. So, funny enough, Surrender and Trump actually are the only two players in the tournament who've only dropped one match. It depends. Sometimes losing one critical game is more important than losing in the group stages. So that's how it is. A bit unfortunate for Surrender, but maybe he can take some more pride from Lifecoach here.
Yeah, and there's also the fact that Trump just won HTC Recharge recently, like you mentioned a bit earlier, like about, what, a week and a half ago? That was very
about a
recently.
Week ago, yeah.
Yeah, so could be another big pickup.
Yeah, a week ago. Yeah, Trump's been in the scene for a really long time. He's placed very well consistently, which is really what matters because, Hearthstone is largely a game of chance, and even the best players, they just trade for tournament wins most of the time. Being able to win a tournament, especially right after another one, it's just really amazing. There's a lot of luck involved in that, but it's not like, Trump gets up in the morning and gets lucky and wins tournaments. It's, a ton of work to prepare. Yeah.
Well, he's been putting in a lot of it. Like, you can tell just from his play in 2015 that he's improved as a player beyond... just the streaming factor. He's actually taken Constructive very seriously, and you can tell, like, it's obvious from his plays that he's much more comfortable with the Constructive play than, playing for pure value is fine in Arena, right? But very often when you transition into Constructed, the fact that the deck has a game plan that's very specific, it takes a little bit getting used to sometimes.
You can't really play for pure value in Arena anymore.
No, that's it? You just go faith?
You go for tempo, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, you gotta trade up. Trading up. That's what's really
about. Is it like zoo versus zoo all day?
Yeah, a lot of the time. Yeah.
Oh, well.
It's in some ways similar to some Constructed decks, yeah.
Yeah. All right. Well, as far as the lineups go, we've already got the first ones for Lifecoach and Surrender. This is the first match we're going to be seeing. It's going to be a best of five, akin to all the matches that happen in the playoffs. Mm-hmm. And then the grand finals will be a best of nine between Trump and Cypher, who will be bringing two extra classes to their basic lineup. So Lifecoach will be playing Warrior, Druid, Hunter. Again, nothing very unusual there, aside maybe from the Druid, I guess, since it's not considered top tier at the moment.
Yeah, but he, I think he does. I mean, in recent tournaments, we see him bring Druid in the Archon team match. We see him bring Druid as well, I believe. Again, it's not been like one of the most dominant decks, but I think Lifecoach has just played it so much that he feels that it's about on the same level.
Yeah, I mean, it's a deck that's never bad. It's just not great. You know, mm-hmm. It's never like, oh, this deck is completely horrible. It'll take wins consistently as a result of some of their consistent tools, but it's just not in its golden era, I guess you could say right now.
Yeah.
Surrender, on the other hand, is bringing Hunter, Rogue, Warrior. So Hunter, Warrior for both players, Rogue for Surrender, where Lifecoach brings Druid.
Really, the interesting thing here is that neither player chose to bring Warlock. That's kind of one of those things that you kind of can throw your opponent off a little bit. I guess unless you're Lifecoach. If you're Lifecoach, you know it's Handlock every single time.
Yeah.
But Surrender, who's a bit less known, who hasn't really had the predictability of some of the other names, I think he can get away with Warlock and the mystery factor in a big way.
Yeah, but he's been playing Hunter whenever he plays, I think he's brought Hunter to his lineup, and it's been doing very well for him. I think it's one of the decks that he pilots, almost perfectly, or if not perfectly. I haven't really seen any mistakes from him. I mean, some people make the argument that it's a deck that's hard to misplay with, but when you're starting to play some of the slower variants, there's some key turns that can sometimes make a difference, and he hasn't really made mistakes on those.
Yeah, generally with the very aggressive decks, the gameplay is easier than what can happen in some of the combo decks and some of the control decks, but usually the mistakes are much more punishing. So if you do end up screwing up, if you do make a misplay, you often will lose a game because of it. It is. Winning a game with Hunter on ladder isn't much. Winning a game at tournament isn't much, but bringing Hunter every single time and beating your opponents every single time, you kind of get that idea.
Yeah. And he's been doing very well with it. Now, I'm curious about, the lineup, the matchups, and how they'll line up between Lifecoach and Surrender, because the Rogue seems to have a pretty good matchup against Warrior and Druid from Lifecoach, depending on how the Rogue is built. I'm just curious to know if Surrender might have brought BGH in his decks, expecting his opponent to play Handlock.
All right. Well, looks like the opener is going to be Rogue into Druid. As you mentioned, I think this is Rogue favored, but I don't think it's much.
I don't know if it's still Rogue favored, depending on how aggressive. Like, Druids, I think, have learned to cope with Oil Rogue. Like, all Rogue players have gotten better, but Druids have had to compensate by pushing for face a lot more, because they can't start playing taunts, because a sap will most of the time just punish you too much. Like, it happens very frequently.
At the same time, I think we've seen double Healbot and Rogue along with Farseer. If the Rogue does have that, it's kind of hard to push for lethal with a Druid, especially if you can't set up a bunch of creatures on the board, because that does end up losing the Blade Flurry. God.
That's good. Harrison Jones already with the Innervate Coin. That's one of the
turn two. Innervate Coin on the Emperor, I believe. Or just an Innervate on the Emperor. Sometimes you might want to just play something a little bit earlier. I don't imagine we'll see an Innervate Coin 5 drop on turn 2, though. That seems a little bit too aggressive.
But the only thing, I think it's only justifiable because of Harrison Jones. I've seen Lifecoach do it, which is why I'm kind of expecting it, depending on how Surrender plays his turn 2. I expect nothing but a dagger, but you would never know. Yeah, he's got options, though, because if he waits for turn 3, then he gets a follow-up Harrison Jones on turn 4 right away. But then a charge of the weapon might be gone.
All right, do you want to play the weapon or do you want to play the Blood Mage? I feel like the weapon is pretty good with the Blood Mage. You're really only gaining the attack. You're also giving your opponent a good turn if you play the Blood Mage, and he has nothing. And as it so happens, Lifecoach basically has nothing.
Yeah, well, the thing about Blood Mage Thalos is there's so many good turns where you can use it. You know sometimes how an Azure Drake will save you because it's giving you that three damage backstab? Right. That's pretty much it, basically.
Much more flexible in that way.
Right. Well, Lifecoach is calculating 17 turns ahead right now. They're both very deep in thought. Mm. And he's going to go for the Blood Mage. All right. So he just wants to cycle. Maybe he hasn't found what he wanted from the mulligan, I guess.
I think Lifecoach is quite happy with that, actually.
Or maybe Surrender knows there's Harrison Jones. Yeah. If he's going to coin out and innervate out Amber Thorson, it's obviously a good turn for Lifecoach.
I just feel Lifecoach may have been calculating some like odds with like Azure Drake and then maybe Harrison rather than pumping out the Emperor. And in doing so, he may have had some really tough decisions. But with Surrender playing the Blood Mage, I think his decision was simplified greatly. So I think Lifecoach is a bit relieved.
Yeah, he's smiling, so I guess that's a plus. He's like, okay, you know what? This kind of makes my turn two a lot easier where I don't have to worry too much about those five drops.
Yeah. Okay.
Hmm.
I guess it's either SI or the Deadly Poison. And the Deadly Poison doesn't seem so good here.
You know, when you have to play SI for tempo, it's all right. And I think in this position, it's actually better than... based on what we know from Lifecoach's hand, it's better. But from Surrender's position, I'm not sure how much I like that. Like, you kind of have to do it, but then you're playing into Wrath. But at least you're throwing the Druid off curve by doing that.
Another thing you could do is maybe just Hero Power. So then you can do a backstab that the Poison and SI next turn.
To remove the innervated Dr. Boom?
Remove anything. Yeah, basically. Okay. Now I think we're going to see a pretty easy Emperor.
I'd be surprised if we didn't. And the good thing about that for Surrender is he's actually going to get a backstab SI if he wants to on that minion, or just the Deadly Poison backstab to kill Emperor. And he keeps his 3-3. But then Lifecoach can get the one charge Deadly with his own Harrison. So it really depends on what Lifecoach is expecting from his opponent.
Yeah, I mean, it just has to be the Emperor here, because, I mean, you just enable a perfect curve afterwards anyway. I think the main reason why you wouldn't is if you wanted, like, a super combo for later, but that feels, like, way too greedy. Like, if you don't Emperor, what do you actually play here? Like, the Azure Drake with an Innervate? I don't know. It seems very clunky.
It's too good not to take, though. I mean, look at the cards you're getting a discount on. Like, Harrison Jones is a perfect card. Azure Drake gives you the ability to use a Wrath right afterwards for 4 damage on 6 mana. Your Sylvanas costs you 5. You've got one piece of the combo for cheaper, and a Keeper you can weave in with a Hero Power. It's like everything is kind of perfect for Lifecoach. He's kind of missing a Wrath, I guess, in his hand to make it optimal.
I feel like the play is the weapon one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You don't want to take 5, but I don't know. It feels a bit weak to just basically play SI and ping 2 face. Which is what you're doing. Otherwise.
Yeah, I guess that's what he could do if you wanted. But I mean, you're basically replacing your SI for the other SI. But then you're not really trying to swing the turn with backstab.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, ultimately, you're still going to end up at the almost same spot. You could sap it, I guess.
For oh, is
wow.
That a sap?
Okay. That's not what I expected.
Well, that plays out kind of fine. That is certainly the highest tempo play that he could make. He still has a lot of the action cards in hand.
Oh, man. Surrender's going to play around that
Harrison
one
a little bit.
Does he have a mind-reading device? Because his plays have been very, you know, far away from using his dagger.
Mm.
Well, Emperor
the good
again?
Thing is, no, I don't think you can Emperor here. The Emperor doesn't really develop that much on the board. And, I mean, the Rogue has 5 cards. You know, whatever you play here, you're going to lose it. So I think you just want to save the Innervate for possibly a bigger turn.
But then you're getting Harrison for 3. And Keeper of the Grove Drake for a total of 5 between them. What to do? Sylvanas on 4? I don't know. It just feels like the mana discount again is really compelling. I would be surprised if he didn't play Emperor again and force his opponent to have the other answer.
Oh, it looks like you're right. Surrender's like, oh, come on.
You've got to be kidding me. I just
sat. He's praying. He's praying.
Well, I don't know if it's going to do much right now. Oh, Shredder. Well, I guess you kind of want to play Lotheb. The thing is, if you do that, you have to backstab trade.
Backstab trade is fine. Mm-hmm. Looks like he wants to do a Lotheb. I mean, a Lotheb doesn't really challenge too much because we had 2 Emperor ticks. So Lifecoach is essentially operating on a 7 drop this turn.
Sounds balanced.
It's a little balanced.
The thing is, like, Emperor Thorsten really pushed Druid. Like, the rent that they got, when they get a good in Emperor turn, it feels like it's even more obscene than the Wild Ghost. Because you can't start playing around Combinatorix at that point. You have no idea what combination of cards they've got.
Yeah.
That's what makes it really difficult.
Shade seems a little bit weak here.
To Blade Flurry, or... Because you've seen Blood Mage, right? So you know he can't go Blood Mage Fan of Knives. So Shade could stick around, I guess.
It just feels like you need a higher tempo turn. It feels like Sylvanas is a little wasted here.
Yeah, but Sylvanas is also not dead to Eviscerate.
No, Sylvanas is basically Taunt.
Yeah.
Like, better than Taunt.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. Like,
if it's Taunt, it could get, like, Eviscerated or something. But if you play Sylvanas, it basically absolutely forces the trade. It basically pushes Lifecoach to the next mana crystal safely. And with the Rogue on 4 cards, actually maybe Sylvanas is the best play.
Yeah, it sounds weird because it's so off-curve, but it's still a 6-cost minion that's coming out. Is Lifecoach just going to go for the deal damage Shade play? It's happening! Alright, so he's going to go for it because he's seen the Blood Mage is my guess. Because now Surrender would have to have Deadly Poison and Blade Flurry to get rid of the Shade. In the next 2 turns, or some kind of oil play.
Alright, well, Surrender goes for the highest tempo play available.
Yeah, if I don't see Sylvanas.
It is pretty good.
Yeah, healing the Lotheb is very, very efficient.
Well, he is able to clear with the Force of Nature Hero Power if he wants. The problem with that is he's going to end with no board. And that's going to give Surrender a really good opportunity to sprint. So you kind of want to do a little bit better than that if you can. And I think Sylvanas is the way better.
Yeah, the thing is, take a lot of damage. The sap is your only weakness, right?
Right, right. You can get that sap again. Also, your opponent could just have like a burst combo with oil.
Yeah,
and you don't really have a finisher.
Yeah, there's 11 on the board already, so I think Lifecoach, if he wants to play defensively and play for the longer game, could at least try to clear off 2 of those minions. Yeah.
Yeah, maybe leave the third up if he wants to be a bit greedy here with the Shade.
I think he will be. I'd be, like, because you're afraid of sprint, but if he sprints, then he doesn't kill your Shade, and then the Shade gets a trade. It really depends on how you're going to be afraid of the Tinker Sharp Sword.
I mean, this play is...
Oh, wow. Good thing he didn't play Sylvanas. Yeah. This would have been punished really
well,
hard.
His play, if anything, was just very consistent. Like, he just went all-out defense mode. And if you're going to do that, the attack kind of makes a great deal of sense. Okay. Wow, that's going to be a nice Vile Teacher. Lifecoach was probably going to pick up a swipe to clear the next wave of creatures from Surrender.
Actually, a few rogues, like, they play double healbot, you mentioned earlier, but some versions actually decide to cut the healbot for the double Vile Teacher, just because they expect Druid. I wonder if Surrender actually expected this from Lifecoach, because if he did, then that might be a one healbot version. Wow, alright.
That's not bad. I think I'd consider playing that over Sylvanas.
Yeah. It's kind of an interesting position for Lifecoach because those two minions are good. Like, tempo-wise, they're both amazing. The thing is, you're potentially wasting your Sylvanas. The drawback is, if Sylvanas gets sapped in any way, then it costs 6 to come back, whereas the Shredder only costs you 4. But it's also, slightly smaller board presence. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I mean, if you just have the board lead on a Rogue, you're in really good shape, and the Shredder kind of enables that to happen. Mm-hmm. I think it's also an okay sap target. I mean, Surrender doesn't know that Lifecoach has a Sylvanas, so he might just burn sap here.
As soon as he sees the second sap, he's going to go for... Like, as soon as Lifecoach sees a second sap, he's going to be very happy about that.
Surrender's probably thinking, like, why did he take so long to figure that out?
You didn't see that Emperor. It's true. I know. It's... You're right.
Like he might be thinking that Lifecoach has like another Azure Drake right now. So many options. You can't really put him on a double discounted Sylvanas. So, well, here comes the Vile Teacher. He can very easily clean up, but the easiest way to clean up involves playing Sap, which would be a bit of a disaster. It looks like he's just going to leave the Shredder on the board. It's very good.
Just go for his own Shredder. Yeah, that's a big point of contention when you make plays is it better to play your own Shredder or remove the opponent's? And very often the proper answer is actually to develop your own. It's only weak in this case to a swipe. If Lifecoach had it, this would be a devastating swipe for Surrender.
It could be. It's not like the most devastating because the Shredder has that random element. Well, you really, really, really want a Dr. Boom. With that many 1-1s on the board, Oil is actually less threatening.
Yeah, because Violet Teacher is like the Violet Teacher is a liability when you're trying to go for an Oil Burst. It's just good for establishing mid-game tempo. Like, and this is already getting a mid in the late game, so Surrender is looking for the damage at this point. But funny enough, like that Harrison Jones has done nothing.
Nothing yet. Yeah. I don't really want to start trash talking Mr. Harrison here. I think he might have a pretty big swing in this game. And Dr. Boom comes down. Shredder goes face. Easy peasy. Oh, there's that one Healbot. So we've seen one Violet Teacher and one Healbot so far. Most decks these days just have a very consistent idea, though. So I kind of doubt he's running one of each. I think he might just be running like double Violet Teacher and just having the one Healbot. Because rogues really kind of struggle with healing. They just get behind a little bit from using their weapon early on. So I think even the double Vile Teacher one, I think, almost always runs a healbot.
Yeah. So this is a position where, you know, very often you're not happy to sap a Dr. Boom, but in this one, I think you're okay with it. You're not, like, you've got damage on the board. I guess if you're afraid of combo, like the second Force of Nature, because you saw the first one used, you might be playing very, very defensively. So that's like the one time where sapping Dr. Boom doesn't accomplish anything. But this is a comfortable enough board to do it.
Oh, the Vile Teacher lives. Impressive.
Oh, wow.
Oh, Blood Mage, not bad.
Okay, so 1-1 takes 4 damage and the Shredder does go through and live. So I think Lifecoach is looking for that swipe. He's been looking for it for a while now, but
there
oh wow. Oh, hello. Easy life.
So,
that's good. Harrison like, Jones and swipe can be played together.
Yeah, it looks like a Harrison swipe here. You probably want to play the swipe first, and you probably want to hero power down the Vile Teacher first, just in case the Shredder pops up.
But what if Mana Wraith comes up, and then you can't kill the weapon?
There's some risk.
And the Nerubar Weblord.
Okay. That belongs in a museum. I guess.
You're not convinced. It's alright, Crip.
No, I think you might be right, actually. I think you have a better incentive to play it first.
Is there anything that actually stops spells on 2? It could be an issue for Lifecoach.
No.
Wait, is there anything else in that play? I don't think so, right? There's only one play he can make.
Yeah.
Oh man, if Millhouse or Succubus comes out here. Or Whirling Zap-O-Matic, actually.
Oh, it is kind of a succubus. The other yeah. kind.
Yeah, the other type of succubus.
Oh, here comes the other sprint. We get to see kind of what's in the deck here. It looks like the double Vile Teacher action. Probably going to drop the Eviscerate down on the Harrison.
Do you think he's not going to keep it for damage? That's the one question at this point I'm curious about. Is with the Druid on 11 health? Well, he hasn't played an Ancient of Lore yet, so you're still worried about that. You know there's a Dr. Boom in his hand. So if he plays Boom, you might have an opportunity to push for damage if you pick up an oil.
Right.
So keeping Eviscerate there would be better. But in the case where you're still fighting for the board, then killing the Harrison Jones.
Well, hold on. If he does the Drake, Eviscerate is 5, Blade Flurry is 2, that's 7. If Lifecoach doesn't hero power, you develop a weapon and attack this turn. Well, no, you could still do the weapon next turn. Because you could prep it out.
Yeah, yeah. So.
Okay. But he does decide to try to save it for damage. So if Lifecoach here does not trade and does not hero power and does not heal and does not taunt.
Okay. Yeah, a lot of ifs.
I think he'll die. Right?
Yeah.
1, 2, 3.
He's got 3, 4. Well, he's going to be like... Yeah, yeah. Actually, I think he's going to be too short.
Yeah, he's going to be short. Too short.
Yeah. No, too Unless... Short. Wait. Can he actually re-dagger and re-blade flurry? No, he's going to be too short on mana. He need a prep for that. Like a third prep.
Yeah.
That's not happening.
No. But he would have it with a weapon buff for sure. So it is a pretty risky situation. What can you do here? I mean, the safest play, I guess, would be to either taunt up or heal up.
Yeah, you've seen two saps, right? Like, one on Dr. Broom, one on some early minion, so you can actually guarantee that Sylvanas and this bear will stay up, unless your opponent has a massive Blade Fury. So he has to have those exact cards.
Okay. Well... you can just like develop the Violet Teacher and then play a bunch of stuff. The other option is the Fan Knives first and then Eviscerate into the Sylvanas. But I think at this rate, if you start using these cards like this,
it kind of works out because you can play your Drake with a prep and then Blade Flurry. Like you kill you kill Sylvanas now with Eviscerate, then you play Drake, prep, Blade Flurry to kill the 5/2. And then you're not dead to combo yet.
Yeah, but it's such a weird situation where you went from like winning by a lot to not dead to combo.
Exactly, yeah. It's one of those moments where I don't think there's a chance for him to really play for the win. He kind of has to clear. Like, he's playing from behind at this point. That backstab would have been really good. Like, he would have actually taken this board very easily with the backstab. Oh.
Gotta do it.
And this Drake doesn't die, that's an upside.
Yeah, that's the board.
Oh, but you're safe from combo after that, right? Well, unless Dr. Boom gets replayed, which you know is gonna happen.
Mm-hmm. Well.
Trade and heal yourself?
Yeah,
and then
I feel
play
like
BGH.
I feel
for
like
tempo.
BGH heal is pretty good.
Yeah.
At the same time, like if you're a life coach, you know that BGH doesn't have much weight. As Surrender at this point has drawn through most of his deck, and you've only seen one backstab. I mean, this is the stage where if you're a life coach, you're really just thinking about what you've seen and what you expect to see. So you do expect to see another Blade 3. You do expect to see another backstab. You don't expect to see another sap, so Dr. Boom would probably stick on the board. But if you Dr. Boom with no taunt up, I think your chance to die is relatively high.
Yeah, from his perspective, he hasn't seen a single oil yet, so it's very easy for him to just get blown out of the game by a second Blade 3 with a single oil, and maybe even a South Sea deck hand. So I think playing safely is ultimately what's going to be the most sensible approach. Oh, wow, he's going to go for the Wild Growth. Okay, wants to cycle to the combo. Or the other Ancient of Lore, perhaps.
Mm-hmm.
Wait.
He didn't activate the draw, but with Lotheb already off the board, it really doesn't matter.
It doesn't matter in this case, but
No. Lifecoach has also played both innervates, so I mean the only one mana card that we've seen in Druid, I think, is Zabi Chow. And I don't think that's in Lifecoach's deck. In fact, I don't think I've ever seen Zabi Chow in Lifecoach Druid deck.
No.
So yeah, this play is just as good as playing the draw card. You know, even though Lifecoach
No
roped,
options.
he didn't have any downside to roping there. It's all right.
Could have been a patron game.
Backstab.
Is he gonna blade fury this, or is he just gonna face tank? He kind of has to face tank.
Yeah, I think he has to face tank here. The Blade Flurry has to try to pick up a bit more value.
Yeah, he hasn't seen a single oil. Does he just run one, or has he just been on the very unlucky streak? Another Drake that will kill the enemy's Drake. It's not
Yeah.
bad, but
That's good enough, man. That's pretty nice, but I think removing the Drake is more important. And
yeah, well,
Lifecoach just
you
saw
haven't
like
seen
two
a salve,
cards.
and you're
Yeah.
afraid of a Blade Flurry, so the Druid of the Claw doesn't change anything, right? You're still weak
You've
to a
seen
big
both
Blade Flurry from
saps.
oil. Yeah, you've seen both salves. That's what I mean, is there's no salve coming from the opponent, and the worry you've got is basically a Blade Flurry, and playing the Druid of the Claw doesn't really solve that at all. The
No.
Stinkers shows up, and
No, I
yeah.
think the play is to Wrath and Hero Power. I think the Hero Power has more value than Wild Growth, but the Wild Growth is a much more complex card. You have to realize like what you can possibly draw into. So, Life Coach has his own decision here, really. Like we have no idea.
I'm almost out of cards.
Okay.
These have to be oils. Those last two cards have to be oils. Like, I don't even know what else it could be. Okay. Is he just
Okay.
gonna play this with a shredder? I mean, you could Blade Flurry attack into it. Yeah, that's right. He could attack into it and be down to 17. Then he's still not at the combo, and the opponent still has to play his own Dr. Boom, I guess. You'd only be dead at double combo, but you've seen innervates already, so you're not worried about that.
I think you just kind of want to be as aggressive as possible, so I think you just hit face with your weapon and just play two creatures, doesn't really matter what they are, and hope that one stays alive so you could oil it next turn. It does seem like the heal bot might be the better creature to play, just making it a bit less likely that you die to combo. But no, actually,
You wouldn't even
both innervates
die.
gone. Yeah, with both
Yeah,
innervates
what's in a
gone,
race?
you don't need
You'd be on
to.
one health. Like,
Yeah.
in the worst case scenario, you're on one health at the end of the combo. So you'd probably be okay. And because you play your dagger right now, the heal bot can be the trigger for oil. If you need to play it and not use the Blade Flurry. That's like the only argument for it is it's kind of hard to weave in that Blade Flurry after you played a 5 drop and the
One
oil.
damage off lethal.
Hearthstone.
Yeah. But
I like Druid of the Claw, right? Like, you kind of have. This is a decent spot for it.
I don't know, like I think just combo in here is maybe good enough. The rogue is down to one card, so like you kind of know exactly what's happening next turn.
So you mean comboing to trade?
Yeah, I mean
Okay, yeah, sure, I can see that. I thought you
like
meant like
how
going full face until she's on one health. Okay.
no, it's like how
Yeah.
do you lose this game? You lose this game by getting oiled, right? So the rogue has one card left in his deck, and like how many creatures could possibly be in his hand?
Southsea deckhand at the very most. But if that happens, then I guess you have to suck it up. There's nothing else you can do. Let's hope he doesn't rope.
Yeah, he's shaking his head. He could rope, actually.
Vitality totem. So he got it done at the very end there, and now he's thinking to himself, I'm gonna die to Southsea deckhand oil, and this is gonna be the end of it. But he's not yet. Actually, he's dead to double
Yeah,
oil,
he's
so
dead. He's
rest in
just dead to
peace.
double oil Blade Flurry.
Oh, Life Coach to the very last card, actually.
Yeah.
This entire thing came down to the very last card from Surrender. One off lethal. Oh man.
Lifecoach. Would it have made a difference if there was a creature left on the board? Because you have to attack him to the taunt. No, the creature would just get buffed for the damage.
Yeah, it would have gone through the Druid of the Claw either way. So I think like Surrender had a near guaranteed lethal unless Lifecoach picked up healing in this case. Well, that's going to be game. I was thinking to myself, maybe he's not running oils and that weird rogue. Because we didn't see them until the last two cards. Like maybe one oil and something else, but that wasn't the case.
Yeah, he needed that exact oil to win the game there. But he got it and it was guaranteed. It was no RNG. It was technically not an RNG top deck. It was the last card in the deck. So, pretty good stuff from Surrender. Seals out the game basically exactly when it needed to. He was out of steam. That was his last chance. But it was good enough in this case. And he does take the first point against Lifecoach.
Yeah, and he's got Hunter Warrior left, and Lifecoach has got his entire lineup with Warrior, Druid, Hunter. So I don't know if he'll go again for the Druid. I know that Lifecoach is a player who doesn't really care what he starts with in a Conquest format. So he says, whatever you start with, just keep going with until you win. You know, the tiebreakers don't matter here. It's not like it makes a difference for him. In the end, he still has to win with the three decks.
Right. In terms of the matchups, though, the decks, I'm kind of curious. You've seen Surrender play quite a bit. I actually have not seen him play before. What is he playing in terms of the other classes? Is he doing like the typical warrior, the typical patron?
Yeah, he plays typical patron and mid-range hunter, which I think a few of his, I think he had two deck lists which were a little more aggressive than the average. Like they weren't hybrid quite, but they had some elements of it. So it was like a mid-range hunter with a bit more aggression, but nothing out of the ordinary really.
Okay, well, I see loot hoarder here. Integrate Patron Warrior, that's a little unusual, but it's understandable. It's a card you can cycle and do something with.
Yeah, it's a card that a lot of Western players have phased out of their Patron decks. That's one of the, I think, differences. There's like a really different metagame on Asia, like the Asian region and the Western one. And somehow, Loot Hoarder has fallen out of favor for some people. And there's a lot of arguments about, you know, which card is better. Because everybody wants the card draw, but...
Yeah, it makes sense. Loot Hoarder, I think, is largely phased out because it dies to a lot of your own stuff.
Yeah.
Like he's got one of the biggest ghouls and he's got death spites. I mean, we can see it there.
I guess it's fine against an aggressive metagame, though. Like, it's giving you a bit more early board. Also, Fiery War Axe has been cut from a lot of patron decks. The second copy of it. Well, not the first one, obviously. Like, he's always keeping one, but the second one is very often cut from Patron.
Well, Frothing seems like you're just getting punished so ridiculously hard from Death's Bite. What
now? Yeah, I don't think he'll go for that.
Well, I mean, he does, almost that's did. A really, like that, yeah. We were halfway to seeing the Frothing play there. We'd click on the card, move it halfway towards the board. Seems like Armorsmith is a pretty good play, though.
Yeah, I mean, it's not even that it's good, it's just that it's not bad and it's not particularly amazing, it's kind of just okay. So, it's better than playing the Axe for sure, or the Ghoul.
Mm-hmm.
Both of which accomplish nothing.
Armor up.
That, you know, that's also very functional because it effectively does the same thing as Armorsmith. Whatever, he can weave it in on turn 4 with the Axe if need be.
Well, Lifecoach still doesn't have much of a play. Looks like he's going to go for one of those as well. Just armor up, boys. He's going to want to save that coin for the Emperor Tharsen, and I think he's going to try to develop the Deathbite next turn, almost no matter what, to try to defend it.
I hope Surrender doesn't read into the Frothing as a, hey, my opponent doesn't read into the armor up as a, my opponent doesn't have coin Deathbite, because that would make no sense at all. No. And then he plays his Frothing and gets punished by it. He wants to get the initiative on the weapon?
It seems like it'll work. I mean, Lifecoach may not play that Death Spite from this.
Yeah. Do you Harrison Jones this, or do you have to wait for Death Spite?
No, you have to wait for Death Spite, because Death Spite is a combo piece. This is just threatening 3 damage. 3 damage is not really relevant, while the combo is really the only thing that matters in this game.
Yeah, and I think Surrender playing the armor up game is like this health discrepancy really adds up over the course of the entire game. It's a really big deal. But then again, you know, Lifecoach has the Emperor Thoris in him, Surrender doesn't. Like, this is something of note. It's really important because that's one of the most important cards in this matchup, especially in the mirror.
Yeah. Well, he could drop like the Ghoul and Armorsmith if he really wants.
For armor,
it's not
game?
Great.
Yeah.
I mean, you're saying he's playing the armor game, so that would be like the armor game.
It'd be consistent with his line of play so far. Yeah.
You could also just do nothing, honestly. Seems a bit risky, though, to do nothing.
I guess you could play the Ghoul and the Armorsmith. You're right. I mean, that's going to give you a lot of armor.
The Ghoul's also an activator, though. Maybe you just play the Armorsmith.
Maybe also just armor up. Then just let him kill those two.
Yeah.
And that way, if he plays a Patron, you still have something of an answer with your axe. But I don't think he cares very much. Man, this is a really good Emperor Thorsen for Lifecoach.
Yeah.
Like, what does Surrender do for it? How does he even kill it?
He's able to kill it by charging the Ghoul into it, I believe.
Oh, wow. What a play.
Yeah. Not very good. Or you can charge the Frothing into it, but I don't recommend that.
Yeah, in this matchup, I think in this matchup what's interesting is the first one to get a Patron board very often just takes it, because the other one doesn't have anything beyond, you know, one damage AoEs to clear stuff. So they have to start using Executes on one Patron at a time. Oh man, is this really going to happen?
No.
Is he going to get two triggers of Emperor Thorsen?
Alright, well, if he's doing this, Surrender is digging for a slam, maybe a shield slam, or an execute, yeah.
Good luck, Surrender. Nope.
Nope. Yeah, two Emperor Thorsen ticks in this deck is just absolutely insane.
Wow, a free Ghoul and a 1-mana Warsong Commander with a free Battle Rage and a 2-mana Deathbite. Count me in.
There's a pretty good chance Battle Rage is just being played here, I think.
I think it's good enough just because the Emperor is going to apply to the new card, so...
Yeah.
It makes everything even better than it already is. Oh, man. Surrender's in a world of hurt here. Yeah, he's probably gonna go for it, as you said. You know, the Battle Rage makes too much sense. Otherwise, it's gonna be an empty turn and you do nothing at all, which, again, doesn't seem very likely. Uh-oh.
That seems fun.
With Inner Rage, it's not strong enough. Yeah, you have to play your weapon and...
Yeah, I think if you shave off 4 more armor and develop that last Deathbite hit, nah, that's good enough.
Yeah, next turn is going to be absolutely disgusting for Lifecoach, because he's getting a Patron for 4 and the Warsong for 1. So for 5 mana, he gets off the first combo pieces and then can follow it up with a Free Whirlwind, Inner Rage, Cruel Task, Unstable Ghoul.
Yeah, it's ridiculous.
I mean, that's basically all the Whirlwinds in the world.
Yeah, Lifecoach basically has infinite Patrons going on right now. Yeah. But in this matchup, to really destroy your opponent... You're going to need that little bit extra. You're going to need the Frothings to make it happen, and he doesn't have those. Surrender does have the Frothings. He does have the Warsong as well, but he doesn't really have enough mana, really, for a long time, unless he draws his own Emperor.
What if Surrender goes for Deathbite and hits face, and then plays Warsong, Frothing, lets the board fill up with Patrons, and then a Whirlwind... and gets like a massive Frothing Berserker. Could that be enough? 8 damage from Deathbite, plus the extra billion from Frothing.
Yeah, I guess at 31, the 5 damage on the board is really not very threatening.
Oh my god, he's doing it. No, he's not doing it. Surrender not going for the all-in, and now Lifecoach is calculating his damage output. So one of them is going to be on 5, and 5 other Patrons are also going to be on 3. So he's going to get 20 damage output right now. 4 with the Deathbite, so it's going to be 2 off. But I think the Cruel Task can... take care of it. Your cruel task would eventually die to your own whirlwind effect, so I think you can get the win. With three whirlwind effects, you can take the game right now.
What now?
He's got it.
I'm impressed of your confidence here. I'm not that confident that he has lethal. There probably is a lethal, but I think it'll be a bit difficult here.
I think it's with the cruel task dying is giving you lethal, because it's freeing up a spot that you otherwise would not have.
Right, but if the cruel task dies, you need to spawn a patron the turn after.
Oh man, the rope might actually get him this time. Because he's going to get another 9 damage here for lethal.
No, he's going to get 2.
Oh my
here.
God, he's...
The whirlwind is enough, though. You're right. The whirlwind is enough.
He's getting 3 right now. Because the 2-0 is going to die, and then the whirlwind for the next.
The 2-0 sticks on the board, see? He had to get the whirlwind and to get the next patron attack. I don't think he has it.
He roped. Oh my god. Lifecoach roped!
Yep.
He had... He was kept in check.
He had lethal, you were right, which is really impressive. Good stuff, by the way.
Oh my god, oh my god, no, it's not happening to him again.
Yeah, double war, he's gonna lose, he's dead.
You know what? Lifecoach actually just did this to Tiddler in Archon Team League. He just did this. Tiddler missed lethal by 3 because of the rope, and then he got killed by frauding from Lifecoach. This should be illegal.
But yeah, the board had to be filled up, so Lifecoach needed that last whirlwind to get that last patron. And because he needed that, you have to wait so much animation time. It's such a demanding turn.
So I think he's just going to queue up the actions here. He'll go face with Death's Bite and then attack with Frauding. And I think that's more than lethal by a tiny amount. Or is it even? The whirlwind should cut it.
Oh, for sure. Look at that. That's another 7 damage on a 16 attack creature.
Yeah, he's gonna be 7 above lethal. Well, Lifecoach did step away, realizing that what goes around.
I don't know if that was stepping away. I think I don't know. I think maybe he needs like a new vase or something.
Well, he lost his glasses, so he might have just crunched them in his fists. Yeah, oh no, never mind. They're there. Disappointed. I was hoping Lifecoach would come back with broken glasses and a broken heart, but...
Yeah. You were right about the lethal. It was just really hard. You had to wait out the animation time, and that's just kind of hard to do sometimes. Sometimes it's just not going to work out. People say I'm pretty critical of plays and stuff. I don't blame Lifecoach for that one at all.
Not at all. No, not at all. I think he played it pretty quickly, like as far as calculating the lethal and then going for it. It was just a matter of executing the entire chain of events. And the extra whirlwind was what basically took too long.
Right, right. Yeah, that's just kind of how it is. Not too big of a deal. Surrender is playing his Hunter deck. You did mention he's doing pretty well with this. I don't know how well you can do with two bows and a glaive Zuku though against the Egyptian warrior.
Kind of weapon clogged right now, it feels, right?
That's pretty good though, the Worgen.
Yeah. Hmm.
Oh, you're gonna take a lot of damage here.
Yeah. The thing is, the weapons look you mentioned the weapons weren't really good for surrender, but then again, what does Lifecoach even have to stop them? Like, that's basically guaranteed phase damage.
Pushing for 7 damage here.
Yeah. This is ridiculous damage.
Well, maybe not. Maybe you'd choose not to abusive, because you have the juggler now.
Yeah, you could weave it in next turn with the hero power.
Yeah, but the juggler might be a liability with, like, Acolyte of Pain or something. So, no, I think this is fine. Oh no, he's going with the juggler, okay.
I guess it's only weak to whirlwind.
Yeah, unfortunately that's what Lifecoach has. Lifecoach is ready for this one. Get in there and fight, maggot. Okay. You'd really want to frothing here, but you just can't. I think you have to whirlwind armor up. You can
there's really no
it
other option.
Extra life, but that doesn't really seem
worth
it.
That could be okay, because if you slam the juggler, Let's assume you just slam the juggler and you wait one turn for whirlwind. You could get a frothing whirlwind, forcing the opponent to have kill command on your minion.
Right. But like the slam doesn't really function as much life gain. You only gain one life because with the two mana, you'd otherwise be armoring up.
Mm-hmm.
So is burning slam worth one hit point? Probably not. You can probably get better value out of that later.
But what if you wait to use the whirlwind the next turn? And you just slam now on the juggler. You just slam once and then pass and then play frothing whirlwind.
Again, I just don't think the slam is worth it. I think
okay,
if you
so
want
you
to
would armor
juggler,
up if you
want
to do
axe.
That.
Yeah. Yeah. Right. I think your play might be okay.
But maybe not as much. I think this one is better by far. Just kind of like considering the follow up.
Yeah.
Surrender looking in this at the stars. He's like, of course he had the whirlwind, of course. And you know what, Surrender? You had every card back when you played that Hunter deck against this Druid.
I feel like Lifecoach could have been greedy there, like you said, but none of those plays would have involved Slam.
Right,
okay,
so
here we go again. The master himself.
It didn't work last time though.
Emperor Coach. Well, no, Lifecoach hasn't won a game yet, but he has discounted a severe amount of mana crystals from his hands. That's kind of like winning.
I guess your mana efficiency goes through the roof, and then you just have to calculate your blowback, and we're good to go.
All right. Well, not much you can do.
It's a great turn doing nothing.
Well, he's going to hit for 4 with the board. He hits for 3 with the weapon. He has 5 next turn with the weapon and the hero power.
Yeah, I think those weapons are not nearly as bad as we thought initially. Like, the fact that they're going to be consistent damage is pretty fine. The thing is, those frothings could just become...
I feel like you have to attack with the frothing there and armor up.
Yeah. I think your health is dipping.
Oh, no, you can't armor if you slam. Never mind. But yeah, your health is kind of dipping right now. And I think
if you hit, you're down to 12, right? So if you're down to 12, then you have. The thing is, by attacking with a frothing, you're getting +2 to each of your frothings. So that's better than attacking with your weapon and only giving them +1. Because you're still forcing an answer from the opponent.
Mm-hmm.
Either way. But the thing is, your frothing then becomes weak to explosive trap. So I think that's the only argument you could make against doing that.
I suppose the trap's probably not the worst thing here, because so much of your deck synergizes with it.
Will you get to draw it? Alright, he's going to go for the trade with the frothing.
Yeah, I think we're seeing really good plays from Lifecoach here.
Right, let's see what Surrender ends up doing. Picks up a mad scientist with the bow. That is pretty sweet.
Is it?
I think he's just going to die a bit too fast, though. Yeah, you're right, because it's actually just letting his opponent play whatever he wants.
Yeah.
Unless you address that frothing on the left. But if you do that, you know your damage is limited unless you top deck Chargers, or maybe a Lotheb, which would then immediately die to the frothing on the right. Oh man, everything you do is kind of bittersweet.
Mm-hmm.
It's too many plays that backfire.
Do you want to take 5 and pump up the other one to 6? I feel like you don't.
Yeah, it doesn't look like something you want to do. You kind of want to force your opponent to use his frothings. Oh, wait. Are you bluffing? Oh, wait. So if he's got explosive, this actually makes sense. Right? Well, he's going to take like a... How much damage is that? Like 50?
Like too much. I'd go with too much.
I don't see that.
I think this play is good because Lifecoach has like a massive disincentive to kill the Mad Scientist, and the Mad Scientist pushes for that 2 damage.
So he's got to calculate how much damage he can get in right now. Like, would you just wait and never trade the Mad Scientist, let Surrender do it on his own terms?
Yeah.
Because that's basically what you're doing at this point, and there's really no other option. No lethal next turn, is there? Oh man.
Oh wow. He does go for it. We don't know exactly what trap that is quite yet, but seems, yeah.
Oh, wow, it's explosive. So if you silence that other frothing, do you keep it for kill command? Da-da-da-da. The questions. Or do you just attack into this and then play the Glaivezooka?
Oh, man. Thing is, the Warriors at 9. Like, you really, really want to seal out this game, but the board is just so dangerous.
Yeah, and the moment he plays more stuff, that explosive becomes dangerous to you. Because then the frothing... You kind of have to silence the frothing no matter what you do, is what I think. Because you can't... If you're going to attack into it or attack in the Warrior, like, whatever you do, you have to get rid of the buff that it gets from the explosive trap. Oh, wow, good thing he did. Because Patron plus Whirlwind would have been a bit of a...
I think the frothing should attack the owl because it's pretty likely to be explosive trap.
Based on the plays you've seen, yeah, I'd say
yeah.
So. So patron armor up, but unleash. Haha. But you have to win anyway one day, so.
Yeah, I mean, the only way you play around unleash is if you play nothing, right?
Yeah, and you're going to be long dead before that happens. Because the moment he picks up one source of damage, you're going to have to handle it and then
start... Well, what if you just Warsong? What if you attack, Warsong, armor?
And then you get Grim Patron with Explosive into Whirlwind?
No. You just don't Grim Patron this turn. So
yeah, I could see that.
You wouldn't die just to Unleash. It'd have to be Unleash plus one damage.
What now? All right, I could see that. Yeah, that could make sense.
And it's like a really dangerous target.
You could play Patron afterwards as well. Yeah, okay, he's gonna go for Patron instead of the Warsong. Okay, so he's gonna maximize his meta usage this turn and still get the Warsong off the next turn. He's only got 7 on board though. Oof.
Oh, that's it.
That's game. Glaivezooka hero power.
Surrender takes it 3-0 over Lifecoach.
I mean, that's... That's what happened the first time, I think, and...
And the glasses are off. Oh, man.
Oh, Life Coach. What happened to you, man? You just got completely demolished here. Again, Surrender.
Yeah, I feel like that Life Coach played great.
Yeah, he did. I agree.
Surrender played great. Yeah, I mean, if you're going to beat a Warrior with a 3-weapon opening hand, going second, that's pretty amazing, so... Good stuff. Surrender takes third place of Vulcun Deckmasters. I think he takes home...
$5,000, if I'm not mistaken.
Not bad.
$5,000, and then he's going to be getting also 20 BlizzCon points. Life Coach as well, who's actually not going home, you know, empty-handed. He's getting $3,000 for his performance in the league, and as well, 20 BlizzCon points. So he's not really... although he doesn't get the Pride win or the Grudge win against Surrender, he's still... Yeah. Doing pretty well.
In fact, he's probably feeling a bit miserable after losing to Surrender twice now. But Surrender, really, like, you know, very, very good player in this tournament. He only lost one game. He only lost one match, I guess, against Trump. Otherwise, through the tournament, he is completely flawless. And I think the only player left in the tournament that has lost one game is Trump. He lost
Trump himself
in the group stage. So, like, if Trump doesn't get first place, actually Surrender would have been the only player to lose only one game.
Wow, that's actually really true. Like, if Trump gets the, I mean, if Trump wins in the finals though, like, he's gonna be
they both would have been on the same footing.
So it's all about Trump
winning on the same footing, but then Trump was finishes. The one who beat Surrender, so it's like kind of cool,
right?
But if Trump doesn't win, it's just a really weird situation where doing really well in the group stage just doesn't count as much as the games to follow.
Yeah.
But hey, that's how it is, man. No complaints. Just interesting sequence of events. Good stuff.
Yep. All right, guys. So we'll be taking a short break before we move on to the grand finals of the entire event. Now, before we go, a quick shout out to Vulcun for organizing the league and to Squarespace.com for sponsoring the entire thing. Again, for those of you who may not be familiar with what Squarespace is, it's a website you can go to actually get your own website set up. It looks pretty professional. It's very easy to use, and it's not very expensive. So check them out, squarespace.com. You can use the Deckmasters code to actually get yourself a 10% discount. So we'll be right back after the break. Don't go anywhere.